Okay, so today Guy is going to speak about PCA and how you use it to improve your model. Guy is from Western Digital. Okay, Guy, please go ahead.
Hi, well, first of all, welcome everybody. Thank you for attending. This meeting is more of a hands-on rather than theory, but I'll still give a few words. But the purpose of this meeting is that you will know what is a PCA, or when you should use it, and how will you understand things from that result. So let's talk about PCA, principal component analysis. The idea of it is, if we have some data with n dimensions, we can reduce the dimensions to a lower numbers, usually to 2 dimension for the reasons I'm about to talk, but to any number of lower dimensions. What it does is, let's look at data before. This is an example of a 2-dimensional data. You can see it's over the diagonal. And you can imagine that the place with the most variance is actually if we place a line over here. And this is the dimension reduction. We take it and we move it along one axis, and then we can reduce the other, the old axis, because it currently has little to no additional information. We just look for each time we want to reduce some dimensions, we just take the projection of it to the place where the variance is the highest, and then we eliminate it. And we go on like this, and we can reduce the dimensions to as low as we choose. But each time we do this, we lose some information. Not all of it, hopefully just a little bit, depending on your data. But this is what it does. Let's just look at how we do it. So as I said, we are hands-on. So this is a code. I'm going to work with 3 clusters. The idea is to create a 10-dimensional data set with, in this case, I have 900 samples. Each one is a scoring of a previous game. You can see the result here was 1, the result here was 2, and so on. Each result can move from 0 to 10. And you want to decide if the next game will have a result of 3, below 3, or above 3. It's a rather simple data set. It's from an actual case we use it for. So, of course, the best way to know it is just a mean in this case, but we use it for any data. So we have 3 clusters, as I say. 1 is for the above, which means for these games, the next game had more, the result was more than 3. The second cluster is the exactly 3, which means in the 11th game, the score was 3. And the last one, below center, which means in the 11th game, the result was below 3. We assume some kind of correlation. It is what we aim to choose. And we want to know if we can actually train a model in it. And we are not sure for some reason. Maybe it's a bad prediction. Each game is completely different. So we have the data. It has its labels. You can see 0 for the result was below 3 in the 11th game. 1 for it was exactly 3. You can't see it here. And 2, it was above 3. And we want to know if we'll be able to learn on it. So as I said, we have 10 dimensions, and we use PCA to reduce it. So we choose to transform it to 2 components, and we plot it. In this case, I've done so the mean is very well separable in this case, so you can also see it in the results. If you look at these results, it's a projection of these 10 dimensions to a 2-dimensional map. You can see that the results are well separated, so almost any kind of model you choose to learn with, you'll get good results. This is a very good indicator that your data is good. And the more I play with it, let's say I make, here we go, in the below, in the games that ended below 3, let's increase the standard deviation, and let's say they had a mean of 2. Usually games like this had a mean of 2, and with the standard deviation of 4. Some of them had like 5, but it's a bit harder to see. So now if we run it, see, it changed a bit. Now, you can get in some cases when the last game was actually 1, 2, or 3, which means below 3, we do have some games with higher. Mostly not. Again, the average will be 2 in this case, but now we have a higher variance. So when we go to the PCA, you see that now these two classes are very, very mixed within each other, which means your data, most classifiers will have trouble sorting this out. On the other end, the blue region is still very well separated, which means you can learn if it will be above 3 or below, but separating between exactly 3, which mean the green dots and the red dots, is very hard. You can try to move it a bit. Let's take it to the extreme. In this case, the 3 is, all of them were exactly here, and the blue are here. You see, this case is a bit tricky. It means you can easily differentiate between the red ones, the above, and it's a bit harder to differentiate between the blue and the green. So in this case, you might try a different trick, like using a classifier to differentiate between one group and the other, and only then you can use some kind of a way to oversample or undersample to separate between the green and the blue. This is one example of things you can learn. Let's say, for now, I increase the standard deviation in all of them. The mean is still kept, but as I increase the variance between the games, it's becoming harder and harder to differentiate between them. In some cases, let's take it again all the way down below. This is another example on the same data set, only change the data just a little bit. In this case, your classifier is not the problem. The data is the problem. You might want to change your data set or create new features. But let's say if your random forest does not work, I don't believe in this case KNN or SVM or any other typical method will solve the issue. This will help you if you want to understand if what you're doing wrong. Is it the classifier, the model you've built, maybe just tricking, changing the model or creating different hyperparameters will solve it? Or in this case, the data is the problem. You need to change the data, not the model. And this can help you decide on what's the next step you want to take for your model to make it better, where you want to direct your effort. Is it the data analysis or is it the model creation? So we always share the code with you so you can try and test it. And you can also take it, I mean, for if you have your own data and use the same technique and visualize it on using the PCA to a two-dimensional map or three-dimensional, which is not in the code. And you can decide for yourself on your own data what is the next step you want to do to create the right model for your data. Any questions?
Was a bit of a short miss. Hi, yes. Thank you, Guy. This was very interesting. My name is Omer. Very quick question. I know that in PCA, you typically have to subtract the sample mean before you apply the PCA algorithm. Is that correct?
As far as I know, it works the same both ways because it's mainly focused on the variance and not on the mean itself. So it shouldn't change the variance. But if I'm wrong, I'll be happy to be corrected and I'll send an update.
Okay, so you didn't perform any pre-processing on the data before you applied PCA?
No. You can see I just created the data, and you can see the data over here. It's game one, game two, and so on. And the samples, and the only thing I did is I just transformed it into a two-component PCA. And you can already see, like I said before, when the data is very well separated and when it is not well separated.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. Ethan, you can stop the recording.
Thanks.
Thank you.